again, everyone. Off and running on this Friday edition of Gulfstream Park Today with Jason Blewett and Ron Nicoletti from our third floor clubhouse studios. Very nice day here in the neighborhood, Ronnie.
Another fast and firm day. We are on the turf, of course, this afternoon, and at Rainbow Six is starting to bill over $132,000. And, of course, every Friday, Stronic 5, Saturday, Thursday, Friday.
That's what?
Friday.
Yes, got the Stronic 5. Couple of races, in fact, from Gulfstream Park in the Stronic 5. And as we come off our opening two-year-old maiden dash of the season here yesterday, that turned out to be a dead heat between two very good-looking fillies, one for Wesley Ward, the other for Mark Cassie. We'll bring on the two-year-old colts this afternoon. In fact, the field of eight will battle in race number 5, and that is the subject of our Friday What's on Tap on this fast and firm April the 12th. Outside of the fifth race, we've got a very good-looking ninth race. In fact, if you just closed your eyes and didn't look at the conditions, I mean, that ninth race today, Ronnie, could easily pass for a grade three turf sprint.
Absolutely, and it's part of the Stronic 5 this afternoon. So a race where I went a little deep in that race because there's a couple of different ways to go. Lots of speed, a couple of good stalkers and closers.
Well, very good Christoph Comont horse coming back off the layoff. That is the Florida-bred Pure Sensation. Now, he will play the favorite role, in fact, in the first race that Gulfstream Park has in the $100,000 guaranteed Stronic 5. That all begins with race number 9 at Laurel Park and basically a 60-minute window from start to finish with this Friday, April the 12th, a Stronic 5, just a $1 minimum. You've got that low 12% takeout, and we're coming in off another near five-figure payday here last Friday, ninth race at Laurel Park at about 5:15.
Yeah, you really have to have your handicapping hats on to hit one of these things, but if you do, you get rewarded and you get a lot of that money back. Oh, it's a 12% takeout.
6:15, the cash out leg at Santa Anita Park. Bob Baffert has a horse in there, and I'm wondering who you used here because it is a very difficult sequence.
Yeah, I found that. I'll show you my ticket. It's $96 in here, and as I was mentioned in race number 5, I went 4 deep in that race, the Gulfstream race. And in Santa Anita, I did use Bob Baffert's horse, but I went 2 deep, didn't want to get knocked out. I could have singled that horse and maybe made my ticket $48, but I figured I didn't want to get knocked out. So you see my progression. Also used 3 in race number 10 with a first-time starter from Mike Maker being the number 5 in that 10th race, which is leg D for the Stronic 5.
Ronnie, 2 deep to start things out in the first leg at Laurel Park, 1-8. I'm a little deeper there. In fact, I've got a 3-horse spread, 1-7-8. I'm most interested in the Jamie Ness horse, the number 8 there, in True to Janine, who's a second-time starter, just taking a very, very needed and realistic drop in class down to a maiden 16,000 in leg A. 2 deep in the Gulfstream leg B. I use the favorite for Christoph Comont. You're not going to get anything close, I don't think, to the 10-1 morning line on Mr. French, the 2, who's just been in raging form. I like him quite a bit, catching a real good horse like Pure Sensation off the layoff. 3-horse spread out at Golden Gate Fields. My single, Carlos horse in the nightcap here. I think Charge at Jen, if she fires her best, she might just finally be in the right spot to graduate from the maiden ranks beneath Jeffrey Sanchez. And like you, did not single the Bob Baffert. Horse, who's, I mean, lost the number 4, Honey from the South, in that last cash out leg. She's been beaten at 1-2, 2-5, and 4-5, right, and is probably going to be around even money this afternoon. I wanted another horse there. I've got the 9 Mind for Mischief as sort of a backup defensive play. Normally, Baffert, you might put all your eggs in one basket. This horse seems a little shaky.
I can't believe you put all your baskets in race number 10 at Gulfstream Park with the 11. That's a good, tough pick there, but yeah. I like it. I like your strategy.
No, I'm pretty confident Charger Jen is going to run a big race this afternoon as we dive into the carryover situation, and not just that Gulfstream Park doubleheader in terms of the Stronic 5. We do have a couple of nice carryovers. The High 5, which gets underway with the first race, a 9-horse field. What we're really interested, though, if we're being candid about it, is that $130K plus in the Rainbow 6.
Yeah, $132,000 plus. We only had one single yesterday. It was a big, big long shot. Did not come in, so thus the carryover over today, and it'll be up around 175,200,000 by the time the smoke clears.
And the early pick 5 does begin. I think when it's all said and done and they spring the latch at about 120 for the first, we're going to be looking at a sub 2-1 favorite in the number 8, Follow His Footsteps, who's dropping off the claim here for Gilberto Zerpa and Mike Nelson. Napoli. That's been kind of the MO of Mike. He's all of a sudden claimed quite a few horses and normally has been pretty aggressive running them back for slightly less than they were initially claimed for. And I like the cutback as well to three quarters for the eight follow his footsteps, as I hope to follow that horse's hoof prints right into race number two with a two horse spread. And I've got coverage the remainder of the way. I see a pretty hot pace, Ronnie, in the second race, and thought ultimately the seven Diamond Majesty might trip out the most in that race. And I'm 2-3-4 to wrap it up. I've got Genghis, the first of for Arundel, Zano, who's the Wesley Ward two-year-old by Verrazano, and let's not forget Positively Awesome, the younger half-brother to a now 12-year-old Jackson Ben, who banked nearly $2 million.
I learned my lesson yesterday with Wesley Ward, so I went four deep when I show you my Rainbow
right.
Six ticket.
Yeah, no, I mean, look, you're dealing, it's only the second week of April. They're all first-time starters, a number of good outfits, a couple of new stallions in the mix. Good-looking fifth on tap this afternoon, but let's talk about this Gilberto Zerpa trained a favorite in the first, follow his footsteps, who's got speed and may not make the lead over the inside horse, Flag It Braze, but I thought would pull that first over trip, ready to pounce, and a slight drop in class off the claim.
Yeah, drops to the 16 level, turns back to three quarters of a mile, due for lead, faded to finish fourth. That's when it was 25. Maiden's going 6.5. We have a stat on Gilberto Zerpa. First start after the claim, sprints on the dirt right here at Gulfstream Park. He's 24 for 58, 41%. 57% in the money and a positive return of investment. And I used the one to Flag It Braze in second, who's getting some class relief. He extended layup to press the pace. He faded against considerably tougher in there.
Had been off for about 14 months before going into that last race and dipping down to 16K. Let's move on to race number two. Opening turf race on the card. Fast and firm, of course, and the weather is just, again, picture perfect for thoroughbred racing as we jumpstart Friday's early pick four with a group of 12, 5, 3, and up. Claimers, I see a pretty hot pace in this race. And look, if your top pick, the six Diamond Mint, is somehow able to survive a duel or control here, he's going to be tough to cut down. I'm just a little worried with him that the five Earth is going to make him run hard early. And ultimately, Ronnie, we'll just to take that exact the box. I thought the seven Diamond Majesty, as you like to say, would be like the trip horse in this race. He was going to get the right kind of trip.
Yeah, he definitely is. But I did go with Diamond Mint, but I'm going exact the box. You see, we got the same. Basically, four horses will try and notch. Diamond Mint will try and finally notch that numbers at three condition. Finished a close-up third in three of four recent races at the distance. So, loves to finish third. We've got to see if he can get over the top today. Elizabeth Dobles, Edgar Zayas is what I like.
All right, give me a little Diamond Majesty over Diamond Mint. Ronnie, the other Diamond Exacta there in the second. Third, back to the main as we bring on these $12,500 three-and-up claimers. And a number of horses are getting some class relief here among them, and this is a race that clearly in many respects goes through the nine-year-old, the number eight Trev, who's got the speed and is just the starting point. I did not pick the horse on top, but hands down they've got to get around Trev and they're going to try to cut him down.
Well, you read the conditions of this race, a three-year-old's enough. Nominal is a three-year-old race since October 31st, excuse me, and Trev's a 10-time winner in this field who fits the conditions of this dated claimer perfectly. Makes his first start, couple of solid performance against those 12-5 state-bred optional claimers before the layoff. Want to show you stat on Georgina Baxter over the last year, layoff of 31 to 60 days, sprints on the dirt. She's 6 for 21, 29%, 57% in the money, and a $4.47 return of investment. I'm going with the old hard-knocking campaigner and Trev on top. Doc Kane and Dunk, my other ones.
All right, 55-day layoff, so smack dab in that time span with the statistic, 31 to 60 days. Now, the number three, Sublime, or So Sublime, meanwhile, is just my kind of horse. Very poor recent form, and the last couple of races, in fact, north of us and out west a little bit at Tampa Bay Downs, but a major change, not only running back for 12-5, which is a claiming price this horse was pretty good at when previously at Gulfstream Park. We're switching from a more low-profile barn to, well, the leading trainer here throughout the winter time in Jorge Navarro. My kind of horse off the trainer change, Ronnie. I'm going to try to shake things up with the number three, So Sublime. Let's move on to the fourth, sprinting on the main. We come up on this three-and-up filly and mare, $12,500 claiming race, and just thinking of owner Mike Napoli and having the current 9-to-5 shot, in the first race. He may ultimately walk away with two wins in this early pick five. He's certainly going to be favored in both as he teams up with the Boogie Mirage off the claim for the seven, Rolling Bobby, who's just with the post and off this win just 30 days ago, in fact, on March 13th, is the filly to beat in this race. And she handled the 7-8. She did it convincingly, and she's posted towards the outside. She doesn't need the lead to win. She's going to be a clear favorite again and looks pretty solid off a very smart victory.
Yeah, she's a three-year-old daughter of a Shanghai Bobby, so she's going to face some older horses in here this afternoon. But you can see this victory here was just so impressive. Reason I put her on the top, I closed it out with Blue Magic and Papa's Girl Blue Magic. It was impressive breaking her maiden on the dirt. Goes back to the main track. She chased and faded against 16-2 Lifetime Claimers going a mile on the turf. Gilberto Zerpa claimed his horse a couple of starts back. He's got his go-to jock, MSC El Jaramillo, in the saddle today. I think that might help this horse out, especially to move to the dirt.
Yeah, back to the dirt, back sprinting again, just getting back to basics, which theoretically speaking will likely work very well with the number five, Blue Magic. I'm too deep here in the early pick five, 5-7, 7-5 to the cows come home. Somebody else happens to get the number. In fact, the boys, 7-5, 1-3, an ice cold super. As we take a little time out with the first segment in the books, we are back with the Rainbow Six and a trip down memory lane, so stay with us.
Whether you're at home or at the track, have a stake in the race when you bet with ExpressBet. Sign up for an ExpressBet online betting account and receive up to a $500 sign-up bonus.
Fast and firm on day six of the newly begun spring meet here at Gulfstream Park. It's Ronnie and Jason catch up with you again for our second segment. Bright lights of our third floor clubhouse studios on a fast and firm Friday afternoon. And not only the Stronach 5 and a couple of local pick fives, we do have that jackpot carryover, about $133,000 in the rainbow.
Yeah, I went with $38.40 today. And as I mentioned, I went four deep in this opening leg because I was saved by the dead heat yesterday, but did not use Wesley Ward in my top three last time. I did have him in my bottom three. So I put this horse Zano on the ticket today. So I went four deep in there. In the second race, the one and the seven. Now, my long shot today comes in race number nine. And it's Sing and Cry in Dubai, just been facing unbelievable horses. He premised in the grade two Shaker Town, finished right behind that horse. And also, you had to use Mr. French on your recommendation. I think that horse might get cooked in a duel, but I didn't want to get beat by him. And I used a first-time starter in the last of five, Judge Kitten. Mike Maker, that race screams for a first-time starter, at least in my estimation.
Well, that's the Kitten's joy. Yeah. Ramsey Homebred, of course, out of, I should say, a perfect soul dam. Yeah, there's turf, spades of turf on both sides of the pedigree, and that horse could easily be live at a full field of lower level maiden claimers in the nightcap. Now, in talking about today's fifth race, we go with the field of eight. You can scratch the number seven, Save Me Paula. All of them first-time starters. And the one real pedigree horse here happens to be the Jacks Are Better Farms homebred in the number four, Positively Awesome. Jackson Ben, one of many successful siblings in the family. We thought it would be fun to take a look back at Jackson Ben with Larry Colmus at the mic, winning the House Hope here in 2012.
These have to go very wide. They're coming to the top of the stretch. It's Successful Mission, Soaring Empire. Jackson bends behind a wall of horses. Now he swings out for his late run. A furlong to run, and here comes Jackson Bend. Jackson Bend moves up to take the lead. Sangaree's going to go with him. Jackson Bend and Sangaree on the inside. Cool Blue Red Hot. It's Jackson Bend in the Hell's Hope. Sangaree was second. Cool.
doesn't seem all that long ago, over 7 years from that win in the 2012 House Hope there with Jackson Ben. I remember even being in New York, Ronnie, when he was a two-year-old and the kind of stir and craze he caused. Because I think if memory serves, he swept all three of the Florida Sire Stakes.
He did sweep all three legs of that, and he ended up banking $1.8 million in his career, Jackson Ben. But there's other stakes horses. We were talking a little early today. You got Grand Shores and, of course, Jackson Ben. So they have really good sires. I mean, horses have come out of this pedigree here and are full to Jackson Ben. So this is a son of awesome, of course. And with the, you know, Ralph Nix training him, I just thought he was the logical one in here. And Ralph Nix, we'll show you a stat on Ralph Nix with his two-year-old first-time start, his maiden special weight on the dirt. He's 24 for 87, 28%. He's in the money 62% of the time. 243 is his return of investment. This is his game.
No, Ralph's terrific with the young horses. And, I mean, he's a horseman's horseman. We know that. Worked for the legendary Hall of Famer Bill Mott for a number of years and has been one of the higher, highest profile guys training year-round on this circuit. And I would imagine this horse is going to take some money. Maybe won't be favored, but I think it's likely going to be, with the presence of Edgar Zayas, it's going to be close in terms of the win pool odds between Positively Awesome and, of course, the number three, Zano, who just looked. And I wasn't overly sold on Marva yesterday. I had like Reiterate, who I thought won the race, but sure enough, seeing the win photo, it was a tie. But again, Wesley Ward, it just, I mean, he's got that uncanny ability where his horses, they break and they almost look like they've maybe been quarter horses in a previous life. I mean, that's how gait sharp they are.
And this one is son of Verrazano. Usually you see some of the two-year-olds that start here for Wesley with like by Ickbad or different horses like that. I think this horse can run well. I saw the back door. You see it's in three, but after yesterday, I said, let me throw this one on my Rainbow Six ticket because I didn't want to get beat 2 days in a row by Wesley Ward.
And a couple of first crop stallions on the outside. Rebelled is by Kozan, who, talking about causing a stir, remember when he was a three-year-old. I mean, he only ran twice, right, but looked like he might be the one in a crop that turned out to produce American Pharoah. And then you've got Summerfront on the outside. Nice little race for the two-year-old colts and geldings there to start the Rainbow Six. Halfway home, as we turn the page, we come up on the opening leg of Friday's late pick five. You get the good feature in the sequence. You also, at least in my estimation, you get a pretty big spread in this opening leg. This race, Ronnie, gave me fits. That first leg A, if you will. I'm 1-4-7-8 to start.
Well, I got the 1-4-7 on my ticket. I think the 8 is who I picked in fourth. I didn't go that deep in it. I thought it was between the 1-7 after the smoke clear when I was handicapping it. So we'll see. Probably a good move by you going a little deeper.
And the 9 Mission Driven in the second leg, race number 7, is the horse to beat. I wanted to use my price horse as well and stepped it up. It's a Friday. I'm in a good mood. It's again, we're 3 weeks out from the Kentucky Derby. I'm putting nearly a $50 bill in there, my friend.
I'm liking that.
That's just under that $50 mark. 4-7-2-4 and wrapping it up with a three-horse spread, including the Kitten's Joy Firster we talked about in the 10th. And I also think Charger Jen is going to run a big race. She may finally, and I'm hoping that's the case, as my Stronach 5 single on the other play may finally have found the right spot. But again, discussing this upcoming sixth race, Ronnie, this three-year-old maiden 50. The layoff for the 7 Cotton House has to be mentioned of about 4.5 months and is a bit of an unknown. I do feel, although I didn't pick the 7 Cotton House, you probably have the right horse in terms of just talking about the race. There may be a case to be made that this horse could be very dangerous today for Maiden 50.
Yeah, Maiden 50, and he's a gelding, and that's why he's here now at this time of the year for Christophe Clement. He's debuting locally for Christophe after knocking on the door on both turf and dirt when facing 50 maidens up at Mac Aqueduct during November. The gelded son of Malibu Moon has got Paco Lopez at the controls. I just thought that was the logical one, but I did use Shaq Carr, and I can understand putting a 7 horse on top of your ticket, too.
Yeah, well, I've got the number 4, in fact, Blue Sky Kitten, along with Shakar, who are coming out of the same race. They both had very similar trips up on the engine. In fact, ran 1-2 essentially around the track before they were picked off late. They both, to me, seem like a snug fit for Maiden 50. And what won me over, they both have some good recent Gulfstream Park turf form over the number 7 Cotton House. But an interesting race, no doubt, on the turf to start things out in the late pick 5. 5. We don't miss a beat as we stay on the turf at a very grass-centric Rainbow 6 here as we turf it around two turns in the 7th at 7.5 furlongs. A race certainly in terms of recent wins and what have you done for me lately. It's hard to argue with Mission Driven, the number 9 going in, who, looking back to this last start on March 16th, was able to win, no, not for the second consecutive time, 3 straight victories. And as we look at the race, I mean, when you consider you're a $16,000 claimer, you're running in 12, 8, 10 horse fields, you're not a speed horse per se, which means you got to get a little lucky and do your thing from mid-pack, whether it be splitting horses or going wide. He deserves a lot of credit here, again, for ringing up the hat trick and a horse who clearly has no issue running inside.
No, it's a very good performance by him, and you mentioned the 3 consecutive wins. He's never tasted defeat here on the Gulfstream Park turf course, so I thought he was the logical one. Had some interest in the 7 Chief Exchanger. He's turning back to one of his best distances, what I like. 5 starts, 3 wins. He stalked the pace throughout. He finished second. That was, well, the 40 claimers going a mile in the 16th. I like this horse much better at this little shorter distance.
It is a good field, though, for a quarter. And ultimately, his Mission Driven steps up a bit. I'm sure there's some people that think he's just ultimately a little faster than these, and that might be the case. And it took me going back to almost 2 years ago when I first moved here. It took a while to finally learn the horse population. But I'm going to give a look to the 5, Escondera, who I feel as though that starter 50 that he comes out of, and he overachieved. He was a big price off the claim for Lily Kurtnitz and nearly won the race behind the man behind the man. I'm thinking that's a field, and his effort, the fact he was in the race and never really quit in running second, stacks up very favorably, if not a little bit better than what he encounters here. But a solid race, my friend.
Yeah, very good. And you're going to get a nice price on your 5 horse.
Yeah.
I used it further down the ticket for all the reasons, ridden by Jairo Rendon, who's just been on fire.
No, Jairo's been doing a great job. I mean, batting almost 50%. I plan on catching up with him today, do a little Twitter video, which we'll fire out this afternoon. Final dirt race, meanwhile, comes down the Florida Turnpike here. Friday's 8th race on the dirt. Got some 3-and-up filly a mare, $25,000 to $20,000 claimers, and a little bit of a disagreement where I like just the drop in class, the switch back to the dirt for the number 4 Motown Cat, my top selection. I also, and clearly you do as well, the 7 Rochette may get the trip in this race with her speed in that post.
Yeah, she's turning back to 3/4 of a mile. She dueled for lead, finished second against those 25 optional claimers. Going 6.5. Mike Yates, Paco Lopez handling that turn back can help. I think go with Worth Avenue, hoping to make amends after breaking slowly. Really got mired in traffic in the upper stretch and finished 5th as the favorite. I thought it was against a notch tougher. I think with a clean trip, I don't know if this is the morning line favorite or not, but I just thought Worth Avenue is the one to beat after that trouble last time.
Yeah,
out.
Take a look.
I'm
Let's check
a look,
it out. I'd imagine Rochette's going to be relatively short or close in price.
Yeah, it was 174.
Yeah, so he's got 5-2 on Worth Avenue, and then what's Rochette? 3-1. So he's basically, that's Jay Stone, of course, basically has them the same price, a matchup, our last dirt race on the card. Up in class, and again, this is a high-level 9th race feature, almost moonlighting as a grade 2, grade 3, 5 furlong turf sprint stake as we go with 8 and a race that just has a lot of quality. And the quality begins, I mean, let's be honest, with a 7-figure winning Florida bred here, a now 8-year-old in the number 4 Pure Sensation, who, and he may ultimately just, if he runs his race, he's probably just too good. But my issue with him, Ronnie, he's now 8, and I combine that with the fact that he came back April 13th here a year ago, was 2-5 in a spot that I don't think was as tough as this field today, and he didn't win that race off the layoff.
Well, you know, he's a multiple graded stakes winner sprinting on the turf. You got to remember that, and it's Christophe Clément. Other reason I looked around differently like you did for that, I wanted to see a race for him coming back in there today. And I just thought that this was a good spot, and there are some really nice horses in here.
Yeah, including your long shot, who has Jorge Navarro calling the shots. And you touched upon it as I was working down the company lines even for a Pure Sensation. You've got a stablemate, Disco Partner, Vision Perfect, Stormy Liberal. But your horse, Singing Crying Dubai, World of Trouble and Imprimis in his last cup.
Yeah, he finished fourth behind Next Out, Grade Two, Shake It Down, a stakes winner, Imprimis last out, and recent Grade One Cardiff Handicap winner, World of Trouble, two starts back. I think he sits the trip. I see a lot of speed. I think Mr. French is going to get hounded by the ultra-fast number 10, Mick Aaron. And I just thought maybe with long shot, he's 15-1 on the morning line. Mm-hmm. How long do you get? How many times do you get Navarro at 15-1? And he'll show you a quick stat before we show you Mr. French's last race. 31-60 days sprinting on the turf. Optional claimers right here at Gulfstream Park. He's 5-15, 33%, 60% in the money, and a nice return of investment of over $4. But Mr. French, you sold me on him. You see all my tickets. I used them.
Yeah, no, and we've got, I mean, that's another subset in this race. You've got the Navarro boys knocking heads, the brothers. Georgie, obviously, with your long shot, and the British bred Mr. French, who over the last half a year has been one of South Florida's best claims. And boy, he has gone through the roof, and that culminated that current win streak for Marcio Navarro. Came to a head here back in the middle of February. He was up in class yet again, facing not the kind of firepower that he's going to encounter in today's ninth race. But he still took down and did it convincingly. A very good field. And I love the fact, Ronnie, not only the figures he's been running, fact that he can beat you on the lead, he can stalk. If he sits a pocket trip, he can still pass horses. He is just, he's really blown me away, this horse, with just how good he's been at ascending levels every time he's run for Marcial.
Yeah, it wasn't long ago that he ran one for $8,000. So yeah. That was my thought process with him. I thought that this was, as we mentioned, graded stakes place horses that have been facing some of the greatest sprinters in the country. This horse might be in a little deep today, but talking to you yesterday, as I mentioned, sold me to add it to my ticket, my Rainbow Six ticket.
Yeah, it's a big test for him, but he's in the same boat as a few of the others, including the layoff runner, Pure Sensation, and we've got two in the race for Jason Service, including McGarren.
Ooh, that was fast.
This horse ran gigantic. I have a feeling the way they're going to bet this race, Pure Sensation, McGarren, and again, 10-1 to me anyway, seems way too high in Mr. French. I think all three of them will be relatively close, but a very good field, and it underscores, I think, Ronnie, just how good of a turf sprint division we have on this circuit year round, not just during the winter time.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward for this race because I'm going to see if I can get this Sing and Cry in Dubai up there that's going to sit that trip. So I'll be taking my shot this afternoon, but used all those horses on my Rainbow Six. That's a tough race and a good race.
Yeah, it is. And no Paddy Price, no Imprimis, but again, still the gang is there. Some firepower and some good ones in the ninth. Wrapping it up here, race number 10. Again, this also plays part not just in the Rainbow and our late five, but a Astronic 5 race. We've got some three-year-old filly, 20K maiden claimers in the nightcap at 7.5 furlongs. And I had mentioned a few times already the drop to 20 with the 11 Charge It Jen, who's run, I feel as though she's run the best races. Not to say that she's been dynamite in her six races to date, but those losses, narrowly beaten losses in December and January for maiden 50, as she drops into maiden 20, with Carlo Vacareza saying, you know what, he's going to maybe dial back in the near future on training, maybe trying to get a nice win for Charger Jen here. She's in for the 20.
Well, I don't agree with you, but I like your choice. And I just thought the outside post with going the about 7.5 was going to be tough for this horse today. And as I said at the top of the show, I just think this race screams for a first-time starter. And what better first-time starter than a horse by Kitten's Joy out of the Mike Maker Barn, Princess Gabby, and Uncaptured Angel. Maybe I'll go back and revisit your horse a little later on.
All right, Safi in the mix with Uncaptured Angel, as is Pete Aiello, is coming your way after we depart. You'll have Ronnie and I, of course, with you all day downstairs, but Pete's coming up next with those Friday scratches and changes.